All right, so let's take a look at a energy balance problem here. This deals with a adiabatic reaction occurring in a tubular packed bed reactor. The temperature of the inlet stream, and you're given a composition, although it turns out in this problem that doesn't matter, is 500 K, and the exit stream is 487 K. And the heat of reaction and heat capacities of the components are assumed to be constant, which makes the math easier in this problem as well. All right, and so the first question is this reaction endothermic or exothermic? This is a fairly easy one, I guess. So the temperature goes down from 500 K at the inlet, goes through a packed bed reactor, and comes out at 487 K. And it's an insulated system, so there's no way that the temperature could go down in the way of heat loss, because the problem statement says that it's an adiabatic packed bed reactor. And so the only way the temperature can go down is if the reaction consumes heat. Right, and so this is then clearly an endothermic reaction because the temperature went down with reaction. All right, part B is maybe a little bit more interesting. Okay, we can write a general energy balance for this system as being in a simplified form that the fractional conversion times the heat of reaction is equal to what I'm going to call a m dot Cp and call this an average property. All right, so that's the average heat capacity on a mass basis times the mass flow rate of all the stuff coming in. All right, and what this basically tells us is that the heat capacity of the components doesn't really change with reaction, and furthermore, the heat of reaction is constant with temperature, so that means the heat capacity of the mixture doesn't change with reaction. Otherwise, we would expect a delta H that did change with reaction. And so, because of that, we can treat everything as a mean heat capacity. If that wasn't the case, then we need more information about how the heat of reaction varied with temperature. We need the temperature-dependent heat capacities of components A, B, and the inert. And so if that were the case, we'd have a term that was the molar flow rate of A times its heat capacity plus the molar flow rate of B times its molar heat capacity plus the molar flow rate of the inert times its heat capacity plus the heat of reaction that included what we call a delta Cp term. All right, but that's not the case here, so we have kind of life is easy for us. All right, and that is, we multiply that, of course, by the temperature rate change out minus in, so T minus T naught here. All right, and so what I'm going to do, if we treat all of this as one big unknown, this m dot Cp, we know everything else. All right, and so in the initial case, we're told that the conversion is measured to be 40%, so 0.4 there. We're given a value for the heat of reaction, and we know that this temperature difference is negative 13 K. And I actually should have mentioned that I'm going to divide both sides by the negative delta H of reaction, which is just a constant. All right, so the important thing here is that I have a collection of terms that's just a constant, and I can solve for them, and it's not going to vary if we change, for example, the conversion of the reaction. Right, which we can do by changing the space-time. All right, so all those properties are going to be constant because the mass flow rate and the heat capacity, as we just discussed, have to be constant. And so we can solve for this. Again, I'll make this a mean value. All right, we can solve for that, and I get a value of negative 0.031 reciprocal Kelvin when I do that. All right, now, again, this is a constant. If we change the space-time, so that it is increased by a factor of 2. And so in some cases we might need to do a new material balance with this using the fact that the space-time is double, but actually our life is made easier here because we're told very simply what happens to the outlet temperature. So the outlet temperature goes down an additional 5 degrees, so from 487 to 482. All right, so therefore we have a negative 18 K for this term. All right, but nothing changes in any of our collected constants. So the m dot Cp and delta H are the same as they were before. And so we can just plug those in right here after dividing through the delta H of reaction and use that to just solve for x. And so x then is equal to this 0.0031 times negative 18 Kelvin. And we can solve for that value of x. And it turns out that that will be equal to 0.55 in this case. So one of the points of this problem is really that you can oftentimes, for a back of the envelope calculation anyway, assume things like constant heat capacities over fairly narrow temperature ranges like we have here. It's only a temperature change of 13 K. So the heat capacities will tend to be constant. The heat of reaction will tend to be pretty constant over that range. And that allows you to do fairly simple calculations very quickly. Whereas if you're doing, of course, a detailed plant design, you would want to consider the individual heat capacity terms for components A, B, the inert, and consider the fact that you could have a delta CP term within your heat of reaction that would be non-negligible. But this is a very good way of estimating quickly what would happen to the conversion if the space-time was doubled and you had this change in the temperature.